Ladies and gentlemen, this is my great pleasure to welcome you to the Center for European Studies, especially on the such short notice. This event was organized on Friday, and I'm glad that that we have so many of you here in the room. And I would like to thank Ania Popiel for this entrepreneurial spirit. My name is Grzegorz Ekierd. I'm the director of the Center for European Studies and professor of government here at Harvard. And it's a great pleasure to welcome our guests from Poland. Now, let me begin by paraphrasing a certain well-known 19th century German philosopher. The specter of illiberal democracy is haunting Europe. And one could say the specter of Putinism and Erdoganism is haunting Central, Southern, and Eastern Europe. The EU has a new and very serious problem on the table, and it does not concern only the fact that those new member states refuse to participate in solving the refugee problems. It is much more fundamental crisis of constitutional democracy and the rule of law. And it is not longer the problem of Romania and Hungary. It is now the problem of Poland. It is now the problem of Slovakia. And it well may be a problem for a few other countries in the region. Now, in these countries, the populist parties and government distrust liberal institutions, promote ethno-nationalistic and culturally conservative concept of political community, and stir up the anti-EU feelings. The first target of the new nationalistic governments are the constitutional courts. They consider the courts to be a key obstacle in implementing their illiberal political programs. In the last two decades, these courts emerge as a very important veto player in politics and defenders of constitutional order. So assault on the constitutional courts is also followed by action to take over the public media, purge state administration, and management of public companies. This strategy was charted a couple of years ago by Viktor Orban in Hungary, and the newly elected government in Poland follows up the script in almost identical way to dismantle the powers of the Constitutional Court. That includes a number of proposals to change the rules of nominating judges, increase the size of the Constitutional Court, make the ruling by two-thirds majority, staff the court with nominees of the government, delay rulings on important matters, and invalidate the rulings which were done in the past. So there's a lot of things going on, and this is a very complex issue. Of course, such actions raise serious concerns in Brussels, in Washington, and in Western capitals. Since the actions of those governments violate the Article 2 of the Treaty of the European Union that declares that EU represents a family of countries founded on the principle of liberty, democracy, rule of law, and respect for human rights and fundamental freedoms. Now, the resistance to using parliamentary majorities to dismantle the key elements of the rule of law comes not only from the EU and from Council of Europe, but also from concerned citizens in those countries. And it is my great pleasure to introduce Mateusz Kijowski, who is the founder of Committee for Defense of Democracy, the largest movement in the region devoted to supporting democracy and respect for fundamental rights since the Solidarity Trade Union in 1980. Now, Mateusz Kijowski is a Renaissance man. He studied mathematics, sociology of family, journalism, information management, was an entrepreneur and civil society activist. And in November 2015, he set up the portal on Facebook called Committee of in Defense of Democracy. And in 3 days, there were 30,000 members of that committee. Now, the most important thing about relationship between social media and the action is that the social media action was converted into a real action. This is the problem of many, many social movements today. The committee organized a huge number of protest events in Warsaw and other cities in Poland. There were thousands of people marching in those demonstrations. In December 2015, Mateusz Kijowski was awarded the Freedom Prize by the Association of Journalists for exemplary civic activities, and in particular for organizing peaceful protest in defense of freedom and democracy. It's my great honor to welcome you at Harvard University.
Thank you for this kind introduction. It's a honor to be here and to be able to talk to so many people interested in what we are doing in Poland. I'll try to briefly introduce you in the situation in Poland. Oh, sorry, but we work in an organization, so all details must be ready. Okay, the organization that I represent is abbreviated KOD. In Polish, the letters stand for Committee for the Defense of Democracy. We are not a political party. We do not support or endorse any political party. We are what you might call a grassroots organization. Our sole reason for being is to be sure that democracy and democratic principles do not perish in Poland. If you've not been following current events in Poland, here's the news in a nutshell. Our political discourse has become polarized. The middle class feels voiceless and left behind by the economic recovery. Voters are angry with their elected officials, and our high court is being paralyzed by party politics. Does it sound familiar? Yes, I know you face the same challenges in the United States, but you are not such a young democracy as Poland. Throughout your history, you also have had your strident debates and your deep divides, yet somehow you remain united in a civic belief that differing opinions can be reconciled through the democratic process. In that unity, that faith in democracy that is being threatened in Poland, and it is what brings me here to you today. Over the next couple of minutes or so, it will be my goal to help you understand why an organization such as KOD came into being and give you a picture of how democratic principles are currently being dismantled in Poland. Important dates in Polish history. First, a little background in recent history. How many of you remember 1980? Yeah, sure. It was only 36 years ago. It was significant years because in 1980 Solidarity was born in Poland. Lech Walesa became a leader of the movement that eventually dismantled communism in Soviet bloc. In 1989, in that year, even before the fall of the Berlin Wall, negotiations between communist authorities and the opposition resulted in our first free elections and triggered the process of peaceful transition of power in Poland. As a result, the first non-communist government in our part of Europe was formed, headed by the Prime Minister, Mr. Tadeusz Mazowiecki. Jump forward 10 years to March 1999, when Bronisław Geremek, then the Foreign Minister of Poland, officially presented Madeleine Albright with Poland's act of accession to the North Atlantic Alliance. In 2004, Poland became a member of the European Union and has long been considered the great success story of Eastern Europe, with strong economic growth. It seemed so well going. Yet, as we continue our journey to the present, it was only last year that our tender young democracy was dealt a devastating blow, not from forces outside, but from our very own Polish electorate. 2015 was an election year in Poland. That year we had both presidential and parliamentary elections. Andrzej Duda became president. He represented the ultra-conservative Law and Justice Party, abbreviated in Polish PIS, a most unfortunate acronym in English. In the parliamentary election, the ruling coalition of the centrist civic platform and the agrarian Polish People's Party in power since 2007 suffered a resounding defeat. The right-wing populist Law and Justice Party won majority of seats in both houses of the parliament and was able to form the first single-party government since 1989. These results were shocking, but in retrospect predictable. This tendency to vote against incumbents has also been observed in other post-communist countries. It persists because the region's political parties still aren't very good at representing their constituents' interest and remain at the very bottom rankings of institutions in which the public had confidence. This tendency also suggests that voters in this part of the world find it difficult to hold governments accountable by objectively assessing their accomplishments and failures. Why else could cause voters to behave this way? For the past few years, Poland has been something of a poster child for economic success in the post-communist region. GDP growth has been among the highest in Europe. It had minimal inflation, and it had single-digit unemployment. Polish public finances were healthy, with a budget deficit below 3% of GDP. But that was only half of the picture. While Poland's overall economic health was strong, some groups and some parts of the country were suffering. Youth unemployment was twice the national average. Good jobs were scarce in small towns and rural regions. Many people were working under short-term contracts that carried few protections or benefits. And although Poland was the only country in the EU to avoid a recession after the 2008 global crisis, that distinction came at a cost. The government imposed austerity measures, including pay freezes from some public employees, and private businesses often imposed pay cuts while simultaneously demanding higher productivity. In the face of these contradictions, young, well-educated urban voters lost faith in the moderate civic platform. It's also why PiS was able to garner so much support beyond its religious, socially conservative strongholds in rural areas, winning the plurality of votes in almost all regions and democratic categories. PiS ran a campaign that recognized these widely felt anxieties and hardships. Their election platform called for vastly expanded public spending. It promised to increase the minimum wage and the personal income tax exemption. It offered new child support payments and housing subsidies. It promised free prescription drugs for seniors and to lower the retirement age from the current 67 to 65 for men and to 60 for women. Law and Justice positioned itself as a culturally rightist but economically leftist party, and that proved to be a winning combination. I'll shorten a bit. The victorious party was supported by only 19% of Polish society, as almost 15% of all eligible voters stayed home in that election. However, PiS stoked fears that the refugees and migrants would threaten Poland's national security, religious and cultural identity, economic well-being, and even public health. On the other hand, it seemed that during the parliamentary elections, the Polish voters were re-examining two fundamental democratic values, freedom and equality. Since the fall of communism a quarter century ago, we have enjoyed an unprecedented expansion of liberties, not only of the political kind, but also in social mores and lifestyles. Indeed, for the more traditionally inclined, the peace of cultural change has become threatening. PiS achieved its victory by responding to this combination of fears and needs with promises to both: increase economic redistribution for the less well-off and protect traditional cultural values all at the same time. It's necessary to point out that in 2015 in Poland, we had a strong economy, but individuals and families were not yet thriving. Roads and bridges were being built. The economic indices were good, but the average person was not benefiting from the national prosperity. In addition to that, 25 years was simply not enough time to build a society that had a passion for democracy. The interest for public debate and discourse was not yet developed. Our civic society was weak. KOD was born in the midst of political tsunami when law and justice started dismantling a system of checks and balances by aiming its first attack at the Constitutional Tribunal. I knew that our democracy was in danger and felt an urgent need to do something to prevent the worst from happening. I was inspired by the press article written by Krzysztof Łoziński, a respected Polish freedom fighter from the communism era. He suggested that all people who value democracy and freedom should organize themselves in order to defend our young democracy. In mid-November, I founded a group on Facebook and called it the Committee for the Defense of Democracy. KOD attracted over 55,000 supporters on Facebook in its first month. Its supporters come from across the political spectrum. As a Facebook group that came to life as a result of triggered by the constitutional crisis, KOD was an authentic grassroots organization. Putting a lot of effort and enthusiasm in our actions, volunteers were able to organize our first massive protest on the streets of Warsaw in the beginning of December. Hundreds of thousands of people went to the streets to defend democracy, our constitutional court, and public media. Soon, KOD was protesting also in the front of the Polish embassies all over the world. Let me describe briefly the legal changes introduced by law and justice that triggered our protests. To show you the scale of the changes that were introduced to our legal system during 5 months, consider this. The ruling party introduced and turned into law almost 40 bills. Over 13 of them were fast-tracked without any debate among stakeholders. The parliament worked under cover of darkness, turning bills into law often after midnight. The president was also signing these acts often in the pre-dawn hours. The series of legislative efforts by the Law and Justice Party are designed to take control of a wide array of state institutions. The rationale behind these legal changes seems to be twofold: impairing the judiciary while at the same time strengthening and broadening the powers of the executive. The changes in legislation crucial to our democracy encompassed the constitutional court, public media, judiciary system, police surveillance, and the civil servants. Let me briefly introduce in these areas. Probably the constitutional court is the most important, which we'll discuss later on. So I pass to the others, only explaining now that because of the attack on the constitutional court, it was almost paralyzed. It is not possible to work effectively, not able to work effectively. Therefore, all the others acts are turned into law without any control of constitution. The first big assault on democracy after the constitutional tribunal was the attack on public media. The new law allows for the current heads of state radio and television networks to be terminated and replaced by appointees of the Treasury Minister. European Union and media watchdog groups have expressed concerns over the new law. Frans Timmermans, first vice president of the European Commission, urged Poland not to enact the media law, stressing that media freedom and pluralism is crucial to the functioning of the European Union. The Organization for Security and Cooperation in Europe expressed deep concerns about the media bill. I fear the hastily introduced changes will endanger the basic conditions of independence, objectivity, and impartiality of public service broadcasters, said Dunja Mijatović, a representative of OFSCE on freedom of the media. The Association of European Journalists echoed her concerns. The press freedom group Reporters Without Borders said Warsaw was embarking on an anti-democratic road similar to that of Hungary. This new law, giving the government full powers to appoint and dismiss the heads of the public broadcast media, constitutes a flagrant violation of media freedom and pluralism, said Aleksandra Genesty, the head of the Reporters Without Borders EU Balkans desk. The Polish government rushed through legislation empowering it to appoint the heads of state TV and radio. The law came into effect immediately after being signed by President Andrzej Duda, and the Treasury Minister swiftly replaced senior public broadcast officials. What followed was a predictable house cleaning where well-experienced journalists and editors were fired and replaced by people whose only credentials are their loyalty to the far-right political spectrum. Today, what passes for journalism in our public media is nothing more than government issuing propaganda. The Council of Europe is conducting an inquiry into Poland's media law. Next area under attack is public prosecutors. This new legislation merged the office of the Attorney General with that of the Minister of Justice, which undermines the independence of the prosecutor's office. Now, the Minister of Justice can influence the public prosecutor's investigations. It gives a politician enormous power. Next, what is being called the Police Act. The new legislation allows law enforcement to collect sensitive data through surveillance without court order. It reduces restrictions on police for spying and increases the government's access to digital data. It restricts citizens' rights to privacy and legal resources. The country's ombudsman said parts of the surveillance legislation could be unconstitutional and challenged the law in court. Human rights group Amnesty International described the new law as one that would seriously undermine the right to privacy in the country. For instance, GPS tracking would be allowed without needing prior permission. There is no obligation of immediate destruction of surveillance materials containing information covered by professional confidentiality, such as reporter's privilege or lawyer-client confidentiality. And operation monitoring may last even for 18 months. Furthermore, the authority of the police force was extended to cover so-called internet data, no obligation to submit an application in each instance. The new law does not have a requirement to inform citizens that they were a subject of interest and doesn't offer them any opportunity to question the activities against them. An individual may be unaware and may never learn that his computer was surveyed in such a way. The Helsinki Foundation of Human Rights warned that the legislation may violate an individual's right and that the law is incompatible with the judgment of the Court of Justice of the European Union and EU's data protection regulations. And lastly, the Act on the Civil Service that no longer requires objective qualifications for civil service jobs. Previously, candidates were required to have at least 5 years of experience in a managerial position and were required to be apolitical. This is no longer the case. The new legislation is restructuring the civil service by scrapping the requirements for senior jobs, which allows the government to put its loyalists into key bureaucratic posts. Now, one's right-wing loyalties would be of more significance than one's managerial qualifications. So, here's the bottom line. Our constitutional tribunal is almost paralyzed. Our judiciary system, our public media, and all civil servants are controlled by the ruling party and the government. In a reaction to the events in Poland, the Freedom House issued a statement. These moves by Poland's new government undermine fundamental checks and balances. The government's taking of such radical steps in its first months and with little debate of experts' input adds to concern that its proposal is to increase power rather than strengthen the rule of law. In assessing this constitutional crisis, the Venice Commission concluded that basic human rights and liberties are at risk in Poland. Three American senators, John McCain, Nick Durbin, and Ben Cardin, wrote a letter to the Polish government saying that changes to Poland's constitutional court and media regulations could harm democratic norms, including freedom of speech and independent judiciary. Polish government has reacted angrily to suggestions it is falling short of democracy standard. The source behind the words of actions of Szydło, Duda, and others in positions of power in Poland is Jarosław Kaczyński, the leader of law and justice. He's the puppet master pulling the strings of his marionettes as they go about the assault on democracy. Officially, he's merely a representative in Polish parliament, but in reality, he rules Poland, and happily, the puppets take responsibility for his ideas and actions. Jarosław Kaczyński is driven by resentments. He's obsessed by conspiracy theories built on the idea that the forces of communism and liberal factions have been secretly ruling Poland for the last 25 years. Kaczyński, who was in power in 2005-2007, has a history of leading witch hunts against domestic opponents. He aired suspicions that Berlin, Moscow, and Brussels were plotting against Poland, and his actions raised major questions about Poland's foreign policy orientation and adherence to democratic principles. As I mentioned before, KOD was created to defend democracy, but KOD will also have to protect human rights. It will have to protect those who might be harmed by the regime. Today, those who voice concerns about basic rights are called by Mr. Kaczyński traitors and citizens of worst sort, as in the communist era. People are losing their jobs because they are not members of supporters of peace. We are deeply concerned that the opposition may face repression and persecution. With our legal system controlled by the government, justice for all may not be the case in Poland much longer. KOD is getting ready to respond to such threats. We are organizing help and support for those who might become the victims of peace. We will offer legal, financial, organizational, and psychological help. We also think about long-term actions. Our chief goal is to energize democratic discourse and support the rise of a civil society in Poland. We want to build a society that is strong in diversity, solidarity, mutual respect, and kindness. We want to teach the principle of the democratic process, a process that puts choices in front of the electorate and to give them the intellectual tools for evaluating the choice. KOD will soon initiate a national program called The Space for Freedom. All Polish previous presidents have agreed to support this initiative. We will take this program on the road to cities and rural areas in Poland. We will start a dialogue to offer education, to understand the needs, to talk about aspiration and dreams of Poles. We strongly believe that it will help us all make better choices in democratic elections and teach us respect for each other. I strongly believe that the best antidote for all types of dictatorship is respect for one another and for the rules of democracy. And with that, I would leave you with the words of your own Thomas Jefferson, who said so prophetically in defense of democracy. Bear in mind this sacred principle that the will of majority must in all cases prevail. But that will, to be rightful, must be reasonable, that the minority possesses their equal rights, which equal laws must protect, and to violate would be oppression. Let me introduce now our legal advisor, Bartosz Marciniak, whom I would ask to shortly enlighten the situation about the Constitutional Court, which needs probably more explanation than just some kind of political discussion, as I can propose. So,
thank you.
Two or three minutes, yet, and then we will start the discussion, of course.
So, given the place we are at, let me propose certain framework in which we can conceive of changes that happened in Poland recently. Because to our view, what is actually happening right now is only a result of what occurred in 1989, in 1990, when we changed quite drastically and swiftly and fastly from one regime for the other. So we jumped from the authoritarian regime to a democratic state governed by the rule of law. Well, a lot of people didn't know how to actually use that freedom. They had no clue how to conceive of a life in which they are supposed to be responsible for themselves. And to our view, all the elites back then became mute. They almost assumed that everyone knows how to thrive in such a system. And for these 25 years, at least in my opinion, all this that very beginning was reaching its momentum that we are experiencing right now. Right now, you can clearly read it out from the political statements provided by the ruling party, Law and Justice. These promises they put forth to the people of Poland are just, you can read them as saying, you have always been poor, you have always lived in the system that may put you in the place where you are right now. We will make you stronger, we will provide you with work, we will give you money, we will make you someone. Because that system, because someone, sorry for that word, screwed it up, you had no clue how to do it. But they thrive on pure emotions of people that have no knowledge of how important, how useful, and how much to be appreciated democracy really is. And look at the narrative that is provided by the government itself right now, currently, because the movement, Committee for Defense of Democracy, is being called as Mateusz remarked, the traitors, people working for some evil forces. And since we have always been standing up for the constitutional tribunal that, as Professor Ekiet remarked, was, and in every democratic regime, is the protector of the very framework of the political discourse. And he is the guardian of the old system that is treated by the people, the electorate of Law and Justice Party, as the enemy, the pure enemy that is to be fought against. And if you are not Pole or following, if you are not following news from Poland every day, it's very easy to miss the narrative that one can elicit from the public discourse that is being held currently in Poland. Because legal changes done to the Constitutional Tribunal are effectively not successful. They have never been successful, as the recent ruling, which is a ruling, indicates. But what the government is concomitantly trying to achieve is to deprive the Constitutional Tribunal of legitimacy in front of the in front of the people of the Polish people, saying, "Well, listen, you've got these judges. You've got, as the leader of that party remarked, there exists such a thing as institutional mentality." Because in one of his speeches, he mentioned that since the Constitutional Tribunal was created in 1985 and came to being in 1986, you need to understand it is a product of the communist regime. And it has always been there to stop the good change that we are providing you with. And this is complete misunderstanding, abuse of history, and abuse of the fact that people lack knowledge of their own history. They lack instruments how to thrive in a democratic system. So since they don't want the good change, since the movement doesn't want the good change, well, they are the traitors of the Polish nation. They are the traitor, the traitors of who you are, who you should be, because as we think, people lack the sense of responsibility. And in order to fight that off, We proposed to fight on two levels. On legal level, so far as our constitution allows us to. Therefore, we, for example, we propose a popular initiative, the object of which is to restore the old act on the constitutional tribunal with the approval of the society that is always invoked as the very reason, the very legitimacy source of all the government's actions. And if we achieve, for example, number of 6-7 billion of signatures, which is not likely, but we are hoping for that, then if the government still decides to put that bill from the table at the during the first hearing in parliament, their reasons will become very clear. But at the same time, we want to allow people to understand that the tribunal is actually the institution that has always been there to protect the constitution, the democracy. And at the same time, we want to show these people how they can live in democracy. So the program that Mateusz mentioned, the most important part of it is like the aim to be achieved. But at the same time, we'll be trying to reach out to people to give them, not to sell them, to give them our know-how, that we know how to use democracy, and we will also try to make you understand how important it is, how valuable it is. Because if we have we are famous, we have always been famous for solidarity, not only as a movement, but solidarity as such. And we want to make that solidarity arise again, reach out to these people and show them how blatantly naive one is if that person believes that democracy can be democracy and freedom, dignity of human being, equality can be and should be done away with because someone misses money. That money can be gained. That money can be won in front of a court because we have rights. We have right to go in front of a court and plea for our case. People, many Polish people, for example, don't know that they have certain rights. There's this awesome lack of knowledge that could be used by these people. For example, the American citizens, they know their rights. They know how to use the regime. So the bottom line of it is that we are trying to deal with the government on both legal level and on the level of what is happening within the society. And that is our strongest, that is our biggest strength, because we can reach out to people. Thank you.
Thank you, Mateusz. Let me remind you about the house rules. This event is being filmed and recorded. In the discussion, please mention your name before you ask the question. We are more interested in questions with question mark, not long commentaries. And the reward for participating in discussion is going to be a lunch upstairs after the event. So let me open the floor for questions and very short comments. Professor Kaiser.
I'm Karl Kaiser. I now teach here at Harvard University, but I used to be the German co-chair of the Polish-German Forum for about 20 years, 70s to 90s. It was created by Chancellor Helmut Schmidt. And I went through the earlier transition to democracy, and I'm, of course, very concerned about this reversal. And I was wondering whether the example of your predecessors who changed the regime, whether it isn't something that you could follow. You do one thing, of course, what they did. You create a grassroots movement. That's the most important part. But in those days, your predecessors used the outside world quite skillfully. I remember lots of cases where I co-signed, for example, when Gremi got into trouble, colleagues outside organized. That annoyed the regime, of course, tremendously, but it helped. I think it is very important that you inform the outside in the democracy what is actually going on. Many don't know that. And my question to you is, what do you do to inform American publics, West European publics? That's my first question. My second question is, couldn't you use the existing mechanisms? Poland is a member of the Human Rights Convention, the European Human Rights Convention. Why don't you all go to court? For example, those who lost their jobs, that's a violation of the commitments of the Polish government under that convention. Couldn't you use that in a massive scale to attract attention outside in the European Union?
First of all, the movement was created after an article of Krzysztof Ozinski, who cooperated with KOR in the 1970s, who was a legend of solidarity. So the idea was based on the experience from those times. So we, of course, cooperate with many people who were leaders, who were active during the solidarity, during the previous opposition. So I believe we can use their experience as well. They are supporting us, but we have taken into account also that the times were changed, and the same to solve the same problems, we need to use the different means. So we are trying to use the experience. We are trying to use the support, but we have to build our own strategy and our own way to freedom, I believe. And basically, we need to understand that our organization is very young. It rose very fast because for the last 5 months as it exists, we collected about 20,000 of active members who are working and organizing all the events, all the grassroots jobs and so on. We have to establish a strong organization, establish the procedures. We are working on the structures to support people in trouble, people who the good change was not so good for them. So I believe we'll go also to legal actions for supporting them with the European tribunals. But for the moment, we are starting to build this. So we didn't do it yet, but I believe that also, we are trying to build a community around them to support them, first of all, locally. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Jose Manuel.
And thank you. Jose Martinez, I'm a faculty affiliated to this center. My question is, do you see any real window of opportunity in the international arena and in the European Union institution for your movement?
Yeah, this is a bit connecting to the previous question. Yeah, we have been in Strasbourg when there was discussion about democracy in Poland on 19th January. We were speaking with the leaders of all the biggest political groups. Somehow we helped them to prepare to the debate, which we then saw during the debate. We are in connections with them and trying to help them to better understand the situation and to prepare better steps to support our way back to freedom than to push us out from the community. We are now with a visit in America. We've spoken in many organizations and institutions. We've been to Freedom House. We have been to the Senate Commission for Foreign Affairs. Have spoken, we had a few meetings in the Department of State, so we are trying to build some kind of understanding of the situation, to establish communication paths and to create the possibility of help, which will be very specific and addressed to real problems and not just to questions like, oh, I heard that the democracy is weak in Poland, so what should we do? Maybe some sanctions or something like that.
When I hear the word COD, Jacques Rupnik, visiting scholar at CES, when I hear the word COD, I go back into retro mode, you know, I hear core the old days. So civil society as a form of resistance to the system is back as an idea, and also, as you've described, as a reality that is emerging. So this is what Poland has always been good at, you know, resisting. My question is, you know, we have had 25 years of democratic transition, institution building, party, political formation, etc. This vitality of the civil society is both reassuring and an element of hope for the future, but at the same time, rather worrying to feel that the political sphere is not able to respond in such a situation. Whatever happened, what is your reading about the weakness of political opposition, for instance, why there is no left in Poland? This is the question everybody asks. And also, what would be your, looking to the future, what would be the possibility, in your view, of connecting, let's say, this kind of social movement, civil society organization, with the political sphere? Because one thing is to be opposing something, another thing is then to be able to intervene in the political sphere. And if I may, a second related question is, what's happening in Poland, of course, is not unique. I mean, Poland is unique, as we all know here, in many ways, but it's not unique. I mean, it started in Hungary. We have, you know, similar trends. Look at the Slovak elections recently. Look what's happening in Croatia. What Croatian government is doing to the media is exactly what Korban did, is exactly what the Kaczynski. So this is a regional trend. So is there, in your approach, in your view, the awareness of the regional dimension of it and perhaps some of the implications that may follow from that?
First of all, if our civil society would be so strong, the situation, we wouldn't be in the situation we are now. Yeah. We have some rises of the civic society when there is danger, and then we are a bit lazy, let's say, in this area. I believe that the movement that started now, that rose now, is will have big influence for the situation, but it's still at the beginning. We see the connections with the other countries. We've been we're in cooperation with Hungarian opposition. We had some discussion panel recently at the Gazeta Wyborcza, the biggest daily in Poland, inviting a few leaders of the opposition. So we are trying to see the situation broader. We are trying to cooperate with people from other countries. We also with the Greens from European Parliament. We are trying to do some research in the Europe about the, because you know, the situation that is in Poland or in Hungary or in the countries you mentioned is of course very dangerous, because this just after the elections and the people already chose. But the parties were anti-democratic powers are present in all the countries, and they are rising their potential. So this is not a problem of a country, of a region even, but probably is some kind of crisis of European democracy, and we need to establish some discussion to define, you know, some standards, some basic ideas, some checks which can show us, the checklists to show that if this is really a democracy or if it is well established. I believe that the movement will build a civil society in Poland and maybe then in some other countries, helping to sharing to share the experience, to share the ideas, the information. But we need to understand that this is nothing we can do very fast. The movement must grow. We have to build our self understanding. We have to self educate, to educate our people, to educate then people in other countries as well, probably.
What about the second question Jacques asked about the relationship between KOD and political parties?
We have quite strong relations with political parties, from the opposition parties, which started at the very beginning, but at the very beginning were we were trying to get their support. We said, you know, we are fighting about the basic values. If they are important for you, so you should come to us and be with us. It was not very easy, but they came, and the first big march, there were speakers from all the opposition parties, even from the left side, which is basically not a party for the moment in Poland, but there is of course a left side, and there are some people who are authorities for the left side. So they were keeping speech, they were showing their support. But the situation changed after 4 months, because now they see that we have a very big support in society, that we are very popular. And therefore, now they are fighting for our support, and they are trying to get us for their actions. So basically, of course, we have to be very careful, because we don't want to be connected with one specific party. We cannot be seen as, you know, a youth organization of civic platform or something like that. But we are cooperating. We are trying to force them to start to cooperate each other, because, as you said, they're quite weak. They don't have good ideas about to fight for democracy for the moment, and they're stuck in looking for good positions in opinion polls. Yeah, and not about solving the problems. So we started to prepare some kind of committee of people with big authority, of people who are well known from the previous fight for democracy and freedom, to use this committee to make a big pressure on the opposition parties, people who are not connected to exact parties but are well known in politics, will try to force them to create some kind of, you know, coordination committee of opposition or something like that, because we want them to discuss the basic ideas, the basic values that we need to support, and not the discussion about, you know, taxes or retirement age, which is for the moment absolutely unimportant.
Mm-hmm. But a short intervention.
Just short follow-up, because it might seem quite problematic, because currently all the people support COD, and that's true. It just seems that the parliamentary opposition is somehow mute. All the focus is on the movement, and the opposition parties do something there. But I do believe it is our greatest advantage, because we can reach out to people, we can gain the feedback, and then we can give that feedback under discussion. Because of being, we are able to create certain platforms, and that very fact that we create one big movement is relating to, I'm relating it to your second question, what happened in different states. Well, I must say it is, we should be glad that we are one movement. We do not divide. Because as if you remember in Hungary, you got a reaction to each action of the government. Public, the society will just gather only for certain issue. We, on the other hand, are movement, big movement that watches, that monitors and reacts. But we never split, we never divide. And this is a difference between what happened in Hungary. So we learn from the experiences of different of other states that have been in our position, and hopefully the experience we gain will provide certain energy to other movements should the need be in other states in the future. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Professor Sporiuk.
Yeah. I speak loudly, so my name is Roman Sporiuk. And I am emeritus professor of history. I started teaching in the 1950s. I remember not only 1989, but also 1939, which probably a majority of people here don't remember. And my question is to Dr. Marciniak, if I may direct it, although, of course, I appreciate very much your presentation. As a former teacher and a student of history, I know that there is such a thing as generations. Mm-hmm. There is a generational change. I remember that students at Michigan in Ann Arbor in 1960s were very different from people, students at Harvard in 1990s. Okay, my question is, I took notes from your talk, and you said in 1990, people did not know what it means to live and function in a democracy. You also said, and this is a literal quotation, people don't know they have certain rights. Now, sir, democracy in Poland sort of triumphed a quarter of a century ago. Quarter of a century is 1914 to 1939, for example, to give you an idea of what a quarter of a century means. Now, if in that case, can you tell us if people who are now 25 know more or less about democracy than people who are 45 or those who are 65 and above who are already are not learning much? If we have read yesterday's results from yesterday's primaries in the state of Wisconsin, we are reading in the reports that people who are 25 or 30 live on a different planet from people who are 60 or 65. So my question is, I apologize for that. Can we speak about a generational change in Polish politics? And can we say, maybe on a side comment, did somebody fail Polish schools, Polish high schools, Polish colleges to teach the new generation things which their parents and grandparents did not know? Thank you.
Thank you, Roman. So, Bartosz,
that's a very, very interesting question. I believe we will have a lot to say about that. Well, from my perspective, I was born in 1986, so I am 30 years old. And you have to understand that I know people who graduated from the most distinguished Polish universities who have no clue about the existence of the constitutional court within our system. I'm talking about the basics. This is being aware that the system can actually react to certain changes, but people are not interested in politics whatsoever. People either go somewhere if they are able to leave the state to other countries of the European Union because they want to earn more money, because earning more money is more important than, for example, staying in your own state and try to strive for a better change within your whole little community. And if you ask me whether schools failed, well, I don't want to overgeneralize, but I do believe that the approach, the understanding of the whole democracy idea, the rule of the state governed by the rule of law idea, should be understood better by the teachers. Yes, that's true. It shouldn't be just the pure knowledge that we teach people, well, we've got this court, we've got that court. People still, there is no generational change, in my opinion, when it comes to mentality of how we approach the idea of democracy. Like, I would still hear from young people, like 20 years old people, saying that I will not go to court because someone did a swindle on me on Amazon. Because, why? Because, you know what they say, courts are slow. Courts will not help me. I mean, who goes to courts these days? I don't care. People work on in various ways without a job contract, and even if they fulfill all the conditions that actually make out of the contract they have, a job contract, they will never go to court because they are not aware that courts are there to help them. And if there is anything we can do, we can raise the awareness. And obviously, the educational system, well, I believe there, as an academic, I might say that there is a lot to be changed, but that's not the topic for this discussion. But when it comes to mentality, just last comment, I do believe there are still many teachers that were born, I don't want to offend them, let me explain myself properly. They were born in 50s, in 60s, they still remember the old times. And for them, Well, they taught themselves. They studied the materials they were supposed to give to people, but they themselves might not fully realize how important that knowledge is and how to operationalize it when it comes to its application to real life. And young people, if young people become teachers, a lot of them, if we become teachers staying in Poland, for example, let's just make this experiment. I do believe things will change. But first of all, we need to start going out to people, us, people that do know, in my opinion, how to use democracy, how to show the people, to Polish people especially, that divide themselves between each other, that we need to agree to disagree. And if we show how it is possible, then all the paths are open to us.
Thank you.
About the generational change, of course, 1989 is the very important date as the history stopped then, was finished. Yeah? We got freedom, we started to have a democratic country, so there was nothing to do else. All our dreams were fulfilled. And then a whole generation grew up feeling the freedom is like the air. You don't need to care about this, it's just is there when you need. So this shows why at the beginning of COD, there were almost only people of 35 plus, let's say. They came very, very quickly because they had some kind of deja vu. The first symptoms of the new system, of the good change, shown them that the past is coming back. The young people are not understanding the weaknesses of the lack of democracy, of the lack of freedom. So, of course, this is our fault. This is the fault of the people who are teaching them, who are growing them up, of the parents, of the teachers, and so on. We didn't show them all the dangers, all the important things that one should know to live, to create a democratic free country. But I think that this is going to change and that people are starting to learn. We see many young people who now come to us and start to be active. They start to they are trying to get the experiences from older people. There is some kind of organization created inside of COD, which is called the Young COD, and they are looking for the older people. They are looking for some advices. They are trying to put them into their the things they are doing. I believe we have to just to re-educate the whole generation and to rework the time that we lost for since we thought that it's just everything we need, we already have. Yeah.
Let me push you more on that issue, because it's very important. One of the most surprising things in Poland over the last several months is that peace is getting so much support from young people. Now, when you look at this objectively, this is the luckiest generation Poland ever had in the last 1,000 years, right? Those people can study in any place in Europe, can work in any place in Europe. The number of college students in Poland increased from 400,000 to 2 million over that period of time. I mean, it's really hard to imagine that you can have the generation better place to use the opportunities offered by Europe. Now, you seem to suggest that those people who supported peace are the losers of the transition, that those are people who are left behind, who are working for a little money on uncertain work conditions and so on. But I wonder whether this is true, right? Another explanation you both offered is something about ignorance, that we have this generation of people who know nothing and that is why I cannot use their power to do good things. Now, There is much more dangerous explanation as well, right? That those young people believe in something else, not in democracy. that there is this dangerous new ideology, ideas, nationalism, populism emerging, and the young people need that. So it's not about losing things. It's not about lack of opportunity, but it's about believing in something which is very dangerous.
Yeah, I think that the most important failure of the new system created after 1989 was that we were focused on the economy, on the politics, and not and we didn't notice the society and the community. After, you know, we had of course to rebuild our economical system. We had to invest in the infrastructure and so on. We knew that we have to join NATO to access European Union, but we never discussed about the society, about how to create a community. So people even in a very good situation, they didn't have the feeling of influence, the feeling of being a part of something important. They never thought what they have, what we have, what we are. Why we live in one place? Why we how to discuss, how to debate, how to establish some common directions of development of the country? There was no such a discussion. There was no place for any social discussion. And we were told at the beginning of the transformation that everyone should care about himself, should build his own success. And we focused on that very strongly, and we forgot about the cooperation, about listening to other people. And I think that this is the most important case. Well, now this is what we have to rebuild now. It is people who left before have some experiences, some earlier experiences. They understand the community somehow, but even they didn't felt well in the situation where there was no any community in Poland. Many people said, "Oh, this is not important if I live in Poland, or I can live to anywhere. We have the possibility to travel. We can move anywhere, and there is nothing that connects us to the place where we were born." So basically, many people just were sitting, I would like to live, but I have no money, and this is the only case that keeping them. Mm-hmm. So this is frustrating, of course. Mm-hmm. If we were connected by some idea, basic interest in some direction, some common values, this would make much stronger the society. And there's one more thing I want to say, but I've forgotten for the moment.
Okay, let's use the opportunity. I see a lot of hands, right? So please, could you come give the microphone to friend in the...
Well, I have a quick question. The church, the institution of church, can you speak to it? Because I believe that it's the institution to be blamed for a lot of what you're talking on, what we know, what we are aware, Polish mentality. So I have a question. Would it be possible to use that power, that incredible force that is, the society or masses are kind of held by and intoxicated in a way by, would it be possible in some kind of way to start a intelligent dialogue with some, I believe, maybe more progressive, maybe, first of all, maybe elicit some progressive people within the church institution? I believe there are such, hopefully, maybe. Well, could you please talk to me about it? Because I understand that the whole province and the people who chose Kaczyński and all these horrible other people, they are basically somehow magically governed by those people from church. So
we'll start collecting more questions before you jump on it. So could you pass the mic to your gentleman here?
Hi, I'm Igor Lukas from Boston University. Thank you for your presentation and for all the work that you do. I'm a great supporter. My question is about Mr. Putin's role in all of this. When you look at what Orban does in Budapest, or Fico does in Bratislava, or Zeman does in Prague, I'm sure Mr. Putin must love it because he obviously wants to weaken the European Union, if not NATO and the Transatlantic Alliance. But what I don't get about your Mr. Kaczynski is that he doesn't strike me as a puppet of the Kremlin, unlike perhaps Orban, unlike Zeman, unlike Fico, because these men quite openly, more or less openly, play by the playbook of the Kremlin. Some of them even take money, or people around them have financial interests that are closely tied to the circles around current Kremlin. But Kaczynski doesn't fit into this pattern. What he does objectively actually serves the Kremlin's interests while he remains to be a hardcore anti-Putin, anti-Soviet, anti-Russian critic, right?
Mm-hmm. So we have two questions about Church and about
Putin.
Vladimir Vladimirovich, right?
Okay, about the Church. My friend lives in France. And before the preparations, the last Synod of Bishops, there were a lot of talks in the media about the basic ideas which were to be discussed. And he said that very often there was some kind of distinction. The people said, all the Church believes that there should be some kind of liberalization in the Church, except the Africa and Poland. And it was very clearly connected that the Church in Poland is not a part of the Church of Europe. The Catholic Church in Poland is absolutely lose the ideas, I believe. This for the moment, more a political organization than a church itself. There are probably I should probably add that I was an active member of the church, so this is for me, of course, difficult. There are many people who respect the values, who respect the religion itself, but they can't understand the political role of the church, because it supports anti-Christianic values. It supports, to be honest, because one could say that the church in Poland fights with the words of Jesus Christ.
Yeah? It's the Polish church.
Which he learned us. Yeah? Exactly. So this is something absolutely understandable. And I'm pretty sure that in the hierarchy there are no people who are ready to the discussion, to any discussion. There are, of course, some priests at the lower level who are open, who are ready to start some kind of debate. But they're very often, even the hierarchy, even often close them their mouths. You are not allowed to speak in media. You are not allowed to publish. So this is a really big problem, and probably some time this will be a problem, and we can't have any dialogue with church, and we can't take them into this battle for democracy and freedom.
Excuse me, could you please tell everybody that last Sunday the bishops of Warsaw
read a letter.
It was announced for the public that abortion is the biggest sin, and there's a high penalty for it. So it was announced as if the church is the government, which is horrifying.
Yeah, exactly. This is because the government believes that their success, electoral success, was also enforced by the church, and now they have to pay off this thing, yeah. But the funny thing was that on the same day, almost Pope Francis announced that priests are allowed to absolve the abortion. So this is an absolutely different message coming from Pope Francis and from Polish Church, and this shows the situation, you know, that the Polish Church is totally lost.
Although I would like to remind that to the extreme right on the in Poland, Pope Francis is not a pope. You can you can read it on the internet. You can read it published in newspapers. This is not a pope. This is some lefty who happens to be sitting on the throne of Saint Peter that should belong to someone else, like the
Okay. Even after after on the Big Friday, Big Thursday during the Easter, Pope Francis made a mess with the refugees.
Yeah.
We washed his legs and so on, and people in Poland said, "Oh, this was absolutely irresponsible. He shouldn't do this. This was wrong." And these are people who strongly support the church in Poland. So this shows the picture. And about the Putin, I'm pretty sure that Jarosław Kaczyński does exactly the same what Orban, what Zeman, and all the. The difference is that he is steered wirelessly. He doesn't need any close connection. I'm sure that he's so predictable that probably there are many, that there is a room where there are sitting about 20 guys in Moscow and they're working on how to influence Mr. Kaczyński. Yeah? But they don't need to pay him. They don't need to talk with him. It's so easy.
And the whole Smolensk affair, the catastrophe under Smolensk, it has been always invoked as a certain argument in the political discourse for throughout 6 years. And they had also, and since this argument from the plane, they don't want to give us plane. When we become government, we will elicit that plane from Russians. There's.
Okay, we have many questions. Let me.
I could add just two sentences, because we see, of course, the presence of Putin on the Polish political scene. There are parties, small parties from the extremes, which are supported by Putin. There is a party called Zmiana, the Change, which is very close connected to all the ideas. It's popularized. It supports all the ideas of Putin. they were financed by a businessman who then became a member of parliament from the Cookies list, but now he stopped to support them, and now he supports the nationalists from the very other side of the scene. Yeah. So this shows that they are there. They help, for example, the nationalists helped the Partia Razem, which is the very left party. Supported them to be able to go for elections, not officially, but they helped them unofficially to get some signatures and so on. So there are many activities strongly supported by Putin, but basically I don't believe in any connection, official connections between Kaczyński.
What is the motivation behind? I mean, it's not really in the context of Polish history. This is rather eccentric, isn't it, for a political party to support Putin?
We don't know exactly what drives Mr. Kaczyński. Some kind of frustration, some kind of angriness. But for sure, this is not rational. So therefore, anything can influence him.
In the last row, please.
Hi. My name's Amy. I'm a law student from the UK. I just wondered to what extent there were like women involved in this discussion, because I understand Poland's got a female prime minister and the last one was a woman as well, but I haven't heard anyone talk about any prominent women in any of these discussions. So where are they? Are they in charge in the government? And do they have a role in your movement? And
okay, because we are running gradually out of time, and I see a lot of hands. So let me start from this side, and we'll collect all the questions. So write them down, and then in the end, I will get back to you. Right. So please, Jasza, please.
Hi, I'm Jasza Monk. I'm a lecturer in the government department here. And a fellow at Newmarket. One of the interesting things about a liberal democracy, which is a concept that was only termed actually 20 years ago and seemed still quite exotic 5 or 10 years ago, and now we see it in all of these different countries, is that we haven't seen the end game of a liberal democracy anywhere yet. And so the question that I have is, how do you see this playing out in Poland 5 or 10 years from now? Do you think that Kaczynski will make sure, through his complete control of media and so on, that they win the elections? What happens if they don't? Will they falsify elections? What happens if they have falsified the elections and you're out in the streets protesting against it? I mean, do you think that the very basic of a democratic system, which is that if a government loses, at some point it leaves office, is still in place? Or do you think we're basically in a soft dictatorial world now?
Mm-hmm. Could you pass the mic behind you?
Hi, Matthew Luxman, I'm a master's student in Russia and East Europe studies here. My question was actually about the Smolensk catastrophe, and to what extent do you think the government is playing with this event, and what can we expect on the next anniversary on the 10th of April?
Okay, please.
Thank you very much. I'm Tobias Schumacher. I'm a JFK fellow here at the center and a professor of EU foreign policy at the College of Europe in Warsaw, in fact. I would also like to pick up on the Smolensk accident, but slightly rephrase it. To what extent would you say it is justified to argue that what has been happening in Smolensk some 6 years ago is the very beginning of the creation of a, say, foundational myth of a new order that taps into this notion of conspiracy and mistrust and replaces supposedly the old order revolving around the round table? Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Could you pass the mic to the first row, please?
Thank you. Bartek Bonikowski, or Bart Bonikowski, Sociology Department and Center for European Studies. I have a question about sort of this, a more structural understanding of what's going on, and sort of a related concern about focusing on values and sort of principles rather than on institutions. I think what's going on in Poland is it's got many unique features, but it also reflects what's happening across Western and Eastern Europe and Central Europe, and to some extent what's happening in the United States. A deep distrust of institutions, elites, partly as a result of frustrations among the losers of globalization, neoliberalism, et cetera, with a lot of nuances throughout. But, you know, in the you cite the U.S. as a place where values of democracy are alive and well, but of course most people don't care about politics, know anything about it. The thing you said about Supreme Court, most Americans don't know what the Supreme Court is or does. What's robust so far, and hopefully for a while, are the institutions. Poland's institutions are proving to be less robust because they're young and for a variety of other reasons. So I guess, you know, there is no simple solution, but I do worry that just an education campaign that sort of tries to change people's values won't solve the broader structural institutional problem that in Poland started with neoliberal reforms right in 1990 that basically privatized everything and created a lot of losers of European integration.
Mm-hmm. Let's
thank you. That was a very interesting discussion and the presentation. Just a fact that I would
please
just add to that discussion. 75% of young people between 19 and 29 voted on right-wing parties for peace and justice, for cookies, and for Korwin-Mikke. So that also explains that young people moved away from what we believed so far, let's say the older generation, and they think about something else when they vote. And I would like to ask you if you perceive that movement among young people as part of a general or a more global movement of distrust in democracy that somehow refers to what you were asking about, that we don't only see in Central and Eastern Europe, but we also see in other Western countries in Europe and also in the United States. So, and again, to what was said before, I don't think that education is going to change it, because we already had, as the professor was saying, 25 years of democracy in Poland, and we had the educational system that was referring to democratic values, and now we see a total change in the perspective of the voters. Thank you.
Thank you very much. The last question in the last row, please.
So actually, my question also pursues the kind of same thought that my worry is that only teaching about democratic values is maybe not enough, because I'm Polish. I actually forgot to obey the rules of the house. Barbara Uszczasz, I'm an LLM candidate at Harvard Law. And I can read Polish newspapers, and I do it regularly. You probably follow them more closely, and also you follow more closely the polls. And from what I understand, if the elections were today, the governmental party would win again.
Yeah.
So this is my great worry about what will happen in the future. My understanding is that the part of the frustration of the Polish young generation is that these great careers that happened at the time of transformation are not available anymore. And how do you address that? How do you explain to the young generation? This moment is gone. There won't be those fantastic careers, but okay. It doesn't Thank mean you. You cannot do anything.
Thank you for the question. So we have very few minutes left. Mateusz, you don't need to respond to all the questions. Just pick the ones which you think you would like to comment on.
Okay, I believe we can answer some of the questions later on informal discussions. So about the women, I would say that here's my wife, which is working about the women in our movement as well. So we can you can probably connect in the after the official part. And so of course we have some groups of women actively working for human rights as well. And this is this being done, but details you can get from her. What will be the situation in 5 to 10 years? We basically don't know how it will develop. This is impossible to know anything for the moment, because of the very fast development of the action of the government, very fast development of the social protest. And this is not yet shown everything, even in the opinion polls. We don't know exactly what's going on. We had, for example, an opinion poll about one month ago, which showed the support for KOD activities at the level of 46%, and for peace activities at 42%. But there was 12% people supporting both KOD and peace, which shows basically that we are not against peace, and I believe it's very good understanding, because we are fighting for values. There are probably people who support the social or economical program of peace, but they also support the democracy and also the fight for democracy. This is very messed up, and this is very, very fastly changing, and this is not the good moment to predict anything for a long period.
Can I just add something? Because KOD, by reaching out to people and knowing their needs, let me put it in Habermasian way, so let's take care of the private sphere of life, let's hear what people need, and then let's try to figure out the way in which this can be implemented in a political sphere, by political parties, which we are not. But this is how I see also the movement, right? You will be able to provide this certain feedback that what the movement will demand from the political parties, because there is no going back to status quo. We cannot go back from what happened before peace came to power. This is the final call by our constitutional system. Either we change something or the liberal democracy will perish.
Okay, and I will try to say about the others. Okay, about Smolensk, this is probably I could explain something to try to explain. Of course, this is used in politics. Yeah, this is nothing of important values. This is building, of course, a myth for. But this was not a big beginning of something. And the ideas behind the governing party are much older. This was just very helpful for them, and they are trying to build on that. Their success. Now, about the values, about the institutions, about the education, about the discussion, and okay. Of course, we all know that if there would be an next elections next month, the result would be almost the same as what was recently, and that the governing parties would have a stronger mandate even for governing. And this is why our definition is the grassroots movement, because we have to work with the people who are voting and not with the politicians. Of course, with the politicians too, but we cannot do any simple legal move and say, okay, the situation is solved. People don't understand how the state should work. People don't understand how the institution should work. People don't understand what values are important and which are not. So basically, we need to educate, to self-educate, not in a manner of schools. the manner of discussion, of understanding, of debate, of public debate, with driven, you know, in media, in families, in bars and everywhere. We want people to start to think about the what, why we are living here and what we want here. So, of course, the education in the schools is also important, but this is only a small part of the whole picture. The young people who basically supported the right wing, they have, of course, as many others, a lot of questions. People starting entering in their life, they have many questions. They try to understand. If they didn't get any good responses for their questions, but they got very simple responses, as the right wing gives always. Simple responses. You have problems, here's your enemy. This is as easy as, and no one needs to explain anything. It's just working. So, this is the cause. And this is also why the discussion, why the debate, why analyzing the situation by everyone could help somehow. We, of course, don't have finally everything prepared. We are just starting. We'll learn, being on the way, how to develop our activity. But I believe that the biggest, the most important place to work is the people, where we have to try to understand, try to build the understanding and some awareness of what we really should do and how to develop our country. So I believe in the discussion, I believe in the dialogue, I believe in the values, and I hope this will change somehow the world.
Yeah, thank you very much. I'm afraid that we are going to have many more discussions on Poland in coming years, and this was a great beginning. So thank you very much to Mateusz Kijowski and Bartosz Marciniak for this engaging conversation.
Of course, thank you for the invitation and the great discussion. Thank you all.